You may be seated. I see that there are a couple of guests in church today, and I would just like to mention as we begin Mass that we are on page 39 of the Mass booklet, and we will be beginning with the Litany of Supplication. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, Lord, have mercy on us. Christ, have mercy on us. Lord, have mercy on us. God, the Father in heaven, have mercy on us. God, the Son, Redeemer of the world, have mercy on us. God, the Holy Spirit, have mercy on us. Holy Trinity in one God, have mercy on us. May we understand your holy will. Grant our prayer, O Lord. May we realize our true relationship with you in this life and the life to come. Grant our prayer, O Lord. May we continue to work with you in building your kingdom on earth. Grant our prayer, O Lord. May we unite ourselves with you in the sacred mystery of the altar. Grant our prayer, O Lord. May we recognize the greatness of this most holy sacrifice through which we worship you. Grant our prayer, O Lord. May we feed on the bread of life, no more to hunger. Grant our prayer, O Lord. May we have a share in the offering of Jesus on the cross. Grant our prayer, O Lord. May we who fill our lives with your ideals be joined with you in the supper of the Lord. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we receive always and everywhere your all-pervading presence. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we end our days with your holy name in our hearts and on our lips. Grant our prayer, Lord. Forgive our sins, O God. Grant our prayer, Lord. Cleanse and renew our hearts. Grant our prayer, Lord. Lord, bless us with the wisdom to praise you in spirit and in truth, and by following your holy will, we may gain eternal salvation. Amen. I welcome you here this morning as we continue our Christmas Epiphany celebration. Next weekend, the manger and the Christmas tree will come down after Mass, but the church still continues in that joyous celebration of the birth of Jesus. Long after the world has put away all of the ribbons and the bows and the Santas and the reindeers, but this is not something you can pass by quickly. I do wish to welcome all of you here today. I know last night may have been a late night for a bunch of you. I went to bed at 11 o'clock with the Patriots still playing. I saw this morning they won, and I know that that's like a religion to an awful lot of people. I've got a friend. He's like a nut when it comes to the Packers. He's got a Packer Christmas tree. He names his dog. The first one was Packer. The second one was Lambo. He raises the Packer flag even here in Massachusetts. And I know today, this is not a real religious guy, but I guarantee he's saying an awful lot of prayers today. They go up against Dallas later. So I know that all that stuff is important, but this is really important, and I would like to make a special mention. Reverend Heidi Fronsdale is with us, and I was at a funeral this past Monday for a friend of mine who was an Episcopal priest for nearly 75 years. I turned around to the Reverend who was sitting behind me to ask a question. We started a wonderful conversation, and she has chosen to see what our Holy Name of Jesus is like this morning and to join us for our Women's Ordination Now meeting after Mass. So, Reverend Heidi, welcome to Holy Name of Jesus. It was very nice meeting this past week. So as we do gather now for the celebration of Mass, I ask all of you here to please make a private examination of your conscience. And may we now recite the Confiteor together. I confess to Almighty God, one in the Holy Trinity, who knows the innermost secrets of my heart, that I have sinned in thought, word, and deed, by my fault, by my own great fault. In your presence, O God, I publicly express sorrow for the many sins by which I have offended you. I resolve to amend my life, to improve and sanctify it, endeavoring henceforth to serve you faithfully all the days of my life. I ask all those who dwell within the Church of Christ, the Blessed Mother Mary, the Holy Apostles, Martyrs, and Faithful, who have lived, suffered, and died, gospel of Jesus Christ, as well as you, my brothers and sisters, to witness my confession and pray for me to our Lord God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. May the Almighty and merciful Lord grant us pardon, absolution, and remission of our sins. May our Lord Jesus Christ absolve you, and with his authority vested in me, I absolve you from all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Show us your mercy, Lord.
And grant us your salvation.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And let our cry come to you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Grant, most gracious Father, that in purity of heart, we may worthily fulfill this holy action, established to remembrance, the Last Supper and the death of Jesus Christ, and for our sanctification and salvation. Be present among us, Jesus, our most perfect Master, because you said that where two or three are gathered together in my name, you are among them. We also ask, Lord, that through this holy liturgy, we may experience a spiritual revival and a better understanding of your holy will, bringing us together in one great family, guided by your commandments and by love, truth, and justice.
Amen.
And may we say together, let us pray to the Holy Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, indivisible, revealed in triune power for all time, now, and forever. Glory to God in the highest,
and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. All-powerful Father, you sent your Spirit to confirm the mission of your Son at his baptism. Send your Holy Spirit now upon us, that we may be strengthened in our faith, that we may find joy in serving you and also each other. We ask this through the same Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
The lesson prescribed by the Church for this morning's Holy Mass is taken from St. Paul's first epistle to the Corinthians. Paul, called to be an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God and our brothers Sosthenes, in the Church of God that is Corinth, to those who are sanctified in Christ Jesus, called to be saints together with all those who in every place call on the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, both their Lord's and ours, grace to you and peace from God our Father and Lord Jesus Christ. Here ends the lesson prescribed by the Church. This is the word of the Lord.
Thus says the Lord, in a time of favor I answer you, on the day of salvation I help you to restore the land. Alleluia, alleluia.
Alleluia, alleluia.
The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me.
Alleluia, alleluia.
Cleanse my heart and my lips, Almighty God, as you cleanse the lips of the prophet Isaiah with a burning coal. In your mercy, cleanse me so I may worthily proclaim your holy gospel through Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Lord be in my heart and on my lips, that I may worthily proclaim his holy gospel. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. John.
Glory be to you, Lord.
The next day, John the Baptist saw Jesus coming towards him and said, Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. He is the one of whom I said, a man is coming after me who ranks ahead of me because he existed before me. I did not know him, but the reason why I came baptized with water was that he might be made known to Israel. John testified further, saying, I saw the Spirit come down like a dove from the sky and remain upon him. I did not know him, but the one who sent me to baptize with water, he told me, and whenever you see the Spirit come down and remain, he is the one who will baptize with the Holy Spirit. Now I have testified that he is the Son of God. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Even if you're not a Bible enthusiast, you can probably hear the remnants of this argument in a phrase
that we've probably all heard 1,000 times before. The phrase is the 12 apostles. Now these were the men chosen by Jesus of Nazareth. These were the men chosen to be his closest followers. And Paul was not one of them. Our Paul never ever met Jesus of Nazareth. So even in the familiarity of that phrase, the 12 apostles, we hear that old charge that Paul, how could he be an apostle of Christ when he never knew Christ? He was different. And so right from the earliest days of the church, difference was there, and difference was causing some tension. Now, Paul doesn't deny that he is a different kind of apostle than the 12 apostles, but that doesn't make him any less an apostle, he says. And the reason he never backed down from saying this is because that he believed that he was called by the will of God to be an apostle. On the road to Damascus, to really go over there and to shut down the church, Paul meets Jesus in a vision, in a mystery, in a mystical way. Not in a Jesus of Nazareth walking down the streets of Galilee kind of way, but in a mystical way that is open to each and every one of us. And he said that Jesus called him to be an apostle. Now, he wasn't called by Jesus like Peter and Andrew and James and John as they were out fishing on the Sea of Galilee. He wasn't called like Matthew to leave his tax booth behind. But Paul never doubted that he was called by the will of God. Now, he was called in a different way. He was called for a different purpose, but he was still an apostle of Jesus. Difference doesn't seem to define or limit the will of God. We like to limit and define the will of God, but I think God kind of looks down at us like a kind of a gentle uncle and says, I understand. You know, you're still young. You'll learn eventually. But God's will is a lot more than we can imagine. Difference doesn't seem to matter that much to God, but it matters so much to us. Unity is found in the one will of God, even if we don't know how to express yet fully that one will of God. So I think when all of us come together with our differences, somehow we get better to that idea of who God is, because we're all different, and we're all made in the image and likeness of God. And I think the differences in churches are there because we're different, not because God is so different. And when all of those differences come together, I think we have a better idea of who God is. You know, this past Friday, a bunch of us from the church, we went to see Hidden Figures. What a great movie that is. If you haven't gone, go to see it. There are movies that I go to, and you know, there are points in the movie where you kind of drift, and you're not really paying attention. This movie from start to end was outstanding. It was one of the best movies I've ever seen. It was a good time. Afterwards, we went out, had a little bite to eat, had an adult beverage. It was a wonderful evening this past Friday. And that Hidden Figures is, there's a message in there that when we kind of throw people aside because of the way they look, you know, whether it be gender or race or whatever, we waste so much talent. Difference is not as important as the gifts that we can bring and share. And this message filters down right into the whole of the entirety of the church. The church is everybody who, as Paul says to us this morning, has been sanctified in Christ Jesus. That is everyone everywhere who has been called to be holy and who lives a holy life. He doesn't say anything about you got to be in my church. We're going to talk more about that as we read more and more of 1 Corinthians. He doesn't say you have to believe in me. He says you have to be sanctified. You have to be holy. You have to try to live like Jesus lived. The church is the ones who are saintly people. That's Paul's Bible definition of church, the people who try to be like Jesus. So the church is all of these wonderfully different people who have been sanctified by their faith in Jesus. In other words, no church is more church than any other church just by definition. Church is more church by how we express our faith and our love in Jesus, and how that faith and love in Jesus then helps us to live a life of faith and love. Paul puts it beautifully, the church of God that is in Corinth. The church doesn't belong to the Corinthian people. The church doesn't belong to us here in South Deerfield today. It's not our church, it is God's church. It is the church of God, he says. And it just so happens that that particular church was located in the city of Corinth. Today, that church of God is located in the city of South Deerfield, but it is God's church. But those Corinthians were church not only with those other few that were gathered around them in their house to worship, they were church, because Paul says to us today, they were church with all of those everywhere who call upon the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, their Lord and our Lord. What a powerful message of communion this is. Their Lord and our Lord. And it's so much more compelling than having to base unity on simply uniformity. We are not the same. People are different, and churches need to respect that. The church has never, ever been the same, and that's that message of Paul the Apostle. But it has never been erased as simply the church of God, because the church of God is always the same everywhere, even though it looks different. So we have a lot to do better as church to help share this message of one God and one people, because we are all made in the image and likeness of that one God. There's still far too much separation among us. We all need to take this truth out into the world, even if our own example as church is not yet perfect. If we wait for the perfect, we'll never be able to do any good. And that's the message of Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. He knew in the eyes of Jesus that we are all loved equally. And that's the truth that inspired him to fight to make that equality outside of the church real. A lot of people today, especially young people, don't see the value or the connection between what we do here and what happens out in the world. But it was only one generation ago that a pastor of a Christian congregation began to change our entire world and our society, and to broaden and expand in the promise of our country that it was founded upon, those promises of freedom and liberty and justice that was meant for everybody. And so he saw that as part of an American dream that wasn't being shared though with everybody. So King was inspired, not by politics, not by race, but by his faith. Of course he saw the differences among them, but more importantly, he saw what God saw. That underneath, above, and all around these differences was the all-pervading equality that was based on the fact of God. That God looks past all of the differences, and he sees us. One of his sons, one of his daughters. So may we learn to do the same. May we do that as church, may we do that as Christians, and may we also do that as citizens. Because I'm kind of afraid that our country is splintering in too many directions, that people just in their differences can no longer talk to each other, that people in their differences can't live together anymore, and that scares the bejesus out of us. We need to respect the differences among us, and the overriding fact that we're all the same somehow deep down. And we need to have that respect once again for his difference. And the church can do that, because the church has been teaching that since day one. In Jesus' name may we pray. Amen. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty Lord, as we gather before your altar this long weekend, we begin by praying for all those who are traveling. We pray for their safe journeys to and from wherever they may be heading. We also offer our prayer for a young man who has a mental illness and who has lost his family because of this. Also pray for his family and for their forgiveness. We offer a prayer in memory of Frederick F. Warren on the 10th anniversary of his death. Yesterday, January 14th, is offered by his wife, Teresa, and his daughters, Barbara Stahelski and her family, and Ann Williams and her family. We also offer our prayers for a speedy recovery of Jenny DeMera, who is now at Health South in Ludlow. We ask, Lord, that you continue her recovery so that it may be full, complete, and as quick as possible. We offer our prayers in memory of Edward Wachowski on the second anniversary of his death, that was on January 12th of 2017, as offered by his family. We continue to offer prayers for Alex, who is 16 years old, battling lymphoma, Hodgkin's disease, Alicia, a young mother of three with stage 4 breast cancer, and Liz Bridgman, recently diagnosed with cancer and raising 3 young girls on her own. These prayers are offered by Cindy Benjamin. We offer our prayers for the following, battling cancer, Meg Connors by Ellen and Don Sprosky, Randy Clements by her grandmother Dottie Baronis, Fathers Ray Drada and Maurice Lazelle is offered by myself, Richard Poe is offered by the Poe and Foster families, and Jack Sela, a 2-year-old, is offered by Mariana Foster. We also offer prayers at this time for Frank Sprosky, as offered by the Sprosky, Gates, and Kirkendall families. Are there any intentions you'd like to offer from the congregation?
I'd like to offer a prayer in memory of my stepfather, Michel Pizien, died in France on January 4th of this year.
For your stepfather who passed away in France. Are there, yes, Marietta?
Quick recovery of Chris Kirkendale, Don and Alan Sprosky's son-in-law, who had an emergency surgery this week for an appendectomy.
Okay, and I heard he's doing very well, right, Ellen? He's recovering. Good to hear that. Any other intentions? Yep.
Yeah. January 4th was the 5th anniversary of the passing of our nephew Adam Hadley, who was 2 years old when he passed away.
2 years old. Oh boy. All right. Offer prayers for him. Any others? Also. For all these intentions, Lord, plus the private ones that we bring before your altar at this time, we ask you, Lord, to also bless each and every one of us here gathered, and to also bless those of our parish who are unable to be with us here today, and those of our parish who have chosen not to be with us here today. And for these things together, Lord, we pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Glory be to the Father, to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Eternal rest grant unto them, O Lord. May they rest in peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made, for us and for our salvation. Came down from heaven, by the power of the Holy Spirit, he was born of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate, he suffered death and was buried. On the third day he arose again, in fulfillment of the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of God. He will come again in glory, to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I count one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Through his suffering, my servant shall justify many, and their guilt he shall bear. We receive from your most sacred hands, most gracious Father, the sacramental bread, with the same faith and trust, the apostles and disciples.
Now reach your
Receive this offering, Most Holy Trinity, which we make in remembrance of the Passion, Resurrection, and Ascension of our Lord Jesus Christ, in honor of the Blessed Virgin Mary and all the saints, that it may add to their honor and aid our salvation. May they whose memory we honor on earth intercede for us in heaven. We ask this through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Pray, my brothers and sisters, that our sacrifice may be acceptable to God, the Father Almighty. Amen. Lord our God, receive this our offering and enlighten us, that we may strive for a just and orderly society. We ask this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God. Forever and ever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Father, all-powerful and ever-living God, we do well always and everywhere to give you thanks. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, you sent us Jesus Christ, who conceived by the Holy Spirit, was born of the Virgin Mother, Mary most holy. We have come to know and love you as our perfect Father, through the revealed mystery of your incarnate Word. We praise you, Father, and through your Son now made visible, long to be with you, our unseen God. Therefore, the angels and archangels, with all the saints and the entire church, we lift our hymn of praise to your glory, repeating unceasingly. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We therefore, most merciful Father, through Jesus Christ, your Son and our Lord, most humbly beseech you to accept and to bless these gifts, these presents, these holy, unspotted sacrifices, which your holy church receives from you, imploring you to defend and guide it throughout the world, together with her priests and all true believers of the holy faith. Remember, Lord, your servant. And of all present in this congregation, imbued with faith in your holy care, your rule and fatherly love, wholeheartedly this day, we unite in spirit with all of them, you're the most blessed Mother Mary, Mother of Jesus Christ, likewise his apostles and with all the countless hosts of martyrs and confessors who lived, labored, and suffered for the same holy cause which Jesus Christ sacrificed his life and his most precious blood. Just as they believed, professed, and united with you through prayer and this immaculate oblation, which you have instituted from the beginning of the world and in time have fulfilled through Jesus Christ, and gave it to humanity as a pledge of eternal salvation, so we too this day profess and unite ourselves with you, most gracious Father, in humbleness of spirit, and accept from your hands this holy bread and this precious chalice as a longed-for gift bestowed on us by the Savior of the world as spiritual food and drink. He promised us this food and drink in that moment when he revealed his divine power by the multiplication of bread and feeding with it a hungry multitude of people. Afterward, he foretold the giving of that food and drink to his disciples and friends as more excellent nourishment when he said, "It is my Father who gives you the real heavenly bread. I myself, the living bread, come down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he shall live forever. The bread I will give is my flesh for the life of the world." And afterwards, when the temporal and messianic life of the divine teacher and giver of the covenant was drawing to a close, he gathered into the upper room all those whom he loved in a singular way and had chosen to continue his work of salvation. He spoke to them words of deep love, longing, and resolve. "I will not leave you orphaned. I will come back to you. I am the way, the truth, and the life. You are my friends if you do what I command you. Do not be distressed or fearful. You will suffer in the world, but take courage. I have overcome the world." If you live in me, and my words stay a part of you, you may ask what you will, and it will be done for you. Anyone who loves me will be true to my word, and my Father will love him. We will come to him and make our dwelling place with him. I consecrate myself for their sakes now, that they may be consecrated in truth, that all may be one, as you, Father, are in me, and I in you. I pray that they may be one in us, that the world may believe that you have sent me. I have given them the glory you gave me, that they may be one as we are one, I living in them, you living in me, that their unity may be made complete. Father, all those you gave me, I would have in my company, where I am to see this glory of mine, which is your gift to me, because of the love you bore me before the world began. I myself am the bread of life. No one who comes to me shall ever be hungry. No one who believes in me shall ever thirst. After these and other words of the archpriest in prayer and with holy fervor, our Savior took bread into his holy and venerable hands, and having lifted his eyes to heaven, to you, his almighty Father, giving thanks to you, he blessed it, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat it, for this is my body, which is given for you. In like manner, after supper, taking this excellent chalice into his holy and venerable hands, again he gave thanks to you, blessed it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant, which shall be shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you do this, do it in remembrance of me. Wherefore, mindful, Lord, we, your servants and your faithful people, in remembrance of this Christ, your Son and our Lord, as well as his blessed passion, resurrection, and his glorious ascension, we receive from your own gifts and presents a pure offering, a holy offering, an immaculate offering, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of everlasting salvation. These gifts we receive with a joyful countenance, as from him, who is the giver of all temporal and eternal good gifts, and with an unshakable faith that they will become for our souls a saving remedy. We humbly ask, you, Almighty God, to command that our offering be brought by the hands of your holy angel to your highest altar, into the presence of your divine majesty. That we who receive the most sacred body and blood of your Son from this altar may be filled with every blessing and grace, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Lord, remember your servants who have gone before us with the sign of faith and who have passed on to eternity. To these souls, Lord, and to all who rest in Christ, grant everlasting light. And to those who during life strayed from the path of righteousness, unmindful of your fatherly love, mercifully shorten their suffering. We ask this in the name of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And grant us, your sinful servants, who hope in the greatness of your mercy, some part in fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs and all your saints, who shed their blood for your name. Their hearts were always open to justice and mercy, and with lives patterned after the divine master, merited eternal joy. Number us in their company, Lord, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. By whom you always create, sanctify, revive, bless, and freely give us all these good things. Through him, and with him, and in him, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. Forever and ever.
Amen.
Let us pray, instructed by our Savior's teaching and following divine example, we say with confidence,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom
us, Lord, from all evils, past, present, and future. And by the intercession of the blessed and glorious Mother of God, Mary, together with your blessed apostles, Peter and Paul, as also Andrew and all the saints, grant us peace in our days, supported by the help of your mercy. May we always be free from sin and secure from all disturbance. Through the same, Jesus Christ, your Son and our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, forever and ever. May the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
May the union of divinity and humanity in Jesus Christ bring us sanctification and eternal life. Amen. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, I leave you peace, my peace I give you. Do not look at our sins, but on the faith of your church, and grant us the peace and the unity of your kingdom. For you live and reign forever and ever. Amen. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the living God, by the will of the Father and the work of the Holy Spirit, your death brought life to the world. By your holy body and blood, free me from all my sins and from every evil. Keep me faithful to your teaching, and never let me be parted from you, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. May the partaking of your body and blood, Lord Jesus, not be caused for my judgment. Though I am unworthy to receive this great sacrament, through your loving kindness may become my safeguard and healing remedy. My saving Master, awaken in me a living faith, fervent love, worship, adoration, and a holy longing. Through this communion, make me your willing servant, zealous fulfill your holy will. May it at last unite me entirely with you, my Lord and my God. Grant this who lives, reigns with God the Father, in unity with the Holy Spirit, forever and ever. Amen. I will take the bread of heaven, and I will call upon the name of the Lord. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. May the body of our Lord Jesus Christ bring me to everlasting life. Amen. What shall I return to the Lord for all the graces that he has rendered unto me? I will take the chalice of salvation, and I will call upon the name of the Lord. With high praise will I call upon the Lord, and I shall be saved from all my enemies. May the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ bring me to everlasting life. Amen. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. Body and the blood of Christ. one crying out in the desert, make straight the way of the Lord. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, you have chosen to restore all things to your beloved Son. Grant that through the reception of your holy word and through the reception of this Eucharist, we may submit to the gentle yoke of his most loving rule. We ask this through the same Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. Sacrifice is offered.
Thanks be to God.
May the tribute of our worship be pleasing to you, most holy Trinity. Grant that the sacrifice which I, though unworthy, am offered in the sight of your majesty be acceptable to you, through your mercy may be effective for myself and all of those for whom I have offered it, through Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Almighty God bless you. The Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. John. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was in God's presence, and the Word was God. He was present with God in the beginning. Through him all things came into being, and apart from him nothing came to be. Whatever came to be in him found life. Life is the light of men. The light shines on in darkness, the darkness that did not overcome it. There was a man named John sent by God who came as a witness to testify to the light so that through him all might believe, but only to testify to the light, for he himself was not the light. The real light which gives light to every man was coming into the world. He was in the world, and through him the world was made, yet the world did not know who he was. To his own he came, yet his own did not accept him. But any who did accept him, he empowered to become children of God. These are they who believe in his name, who were begotten not by blood, nor by carnal desire, nor by man's willingness, but by God. And the Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory of an only Son coming from the Father, filled with enduring love.
Thanks be to God.